Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research Incorporated. This is a school and not a church, and neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a non-profit, non-denominational religious and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity into this present day. This school was established as a result of divine vision and revelations given to our founder, Dr. Henry C. Kelly, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. We were incorporated into the state of California in the year of 1958. Since that time, we have established branch schools throughout the United States and Canada in certain foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. Now in this school, we teach by the true and correct names and titles for the Father, the Word, our Son, and the Holy Spirit as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true and correct name for the Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word, our Son, is Elohim. It had been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifest in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It had been improperly substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5 that there are lords many and gods many. But we now know each Lord must have a name, and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title. But unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia will prove that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any letters or characters in their alphabet that will produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and correct name of our Father and His Son. Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Now Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state He is inscrutable and incomprehensible and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of all things. We have Yahweh in His pure spirit state, symbolized on this chart as a fiery cloud. Yahweh in pure spirit is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize Himself, because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. Just as you see, this fiery cloud has been drawn to extend all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart abides within this cloud. In like manner, everything in the creation and the sum total of the universe abides within this pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man cannot perceive of Him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form within Himself as Elohim. This is the Word, our Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested Himself in a physical body and walk the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now, there's only one name given unto salvation, and we must know that name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface to the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called a divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai, and he showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. We go forth in this school to show proof how that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First, is to help you find and know Yahweh our Elohim as he really is and actually exists. Second, is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race or nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third, is to investigate the unexplained spirit law or so-called laws of nature and the powers latent in man. Fourth, is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth, is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth, is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh, is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons, operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth, is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth, is to make known that Yahweh, from the beginning, ordained there is no other name given among men whereby a man can be saved, save in the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth, is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is speak the truth. We have a prayer this morning by Dr. Bud Wunsch, a scripture lesson of 1 Corinthians, the 12th chapter, by Dr. Carlin Wright.
Let us all bow in our hearts and minds. Father, we are gathered together this morning with hopes that we may fulfill, to some extent, your suggestion or command that we take your yoke upon us and learn of you. I know of no other place where we can learn the truth that you have given to the world, and I am so grateful that you have at least called me, and I hope to be one of your chosen. These and other blessings we ask in the name of thy only begotten Son, Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say.
Hallelujah.
Good morning, class. Good morning.
I'll be reading from the Holy Name Bible, containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testament, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts revised by the late A.B. Trainer of the Scripture Research Association. 1 Corinthians, the 12th chapter. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I would not have you ignorant. Ye know that ye were heathens, carried away unto these dumb idols, even as they were led. Wherefore I give you to understand that no man speaking by the Spirit of Yahweh calleth Yahshua accursed, and that no man can say that Yahshua is the Savior but by the Holy Spirit. Now there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are differences of administration, but the same Elohim. And there are diversities of operations, but it is the same Elohim which worketh all in all. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit withal. For to one is given by the Spirit the word of wisdom, to another the word of knowledge by the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another the gift of healing by the same Spirit, to another the working of the miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, to another various kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. But all these worketh that one and the same Spirit, dividing to every man severally as he will. For as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of that one body being members are one body, so also is the Messiah. For by one Spirit are we all immersed into one body, whether we be Jew or Gentile, whether we be bond or free, and have been all made to drink into one Spirit. For the body is not one member, but many. If the foot shall say, because I am not the hand, I am not the body, it is therefore not of the body. Is it therefore not of the body? And if the ear shall say, because I am not the eye, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? If the whole body were an eye, where were the hearing? If the whole were hearing, where were the smelling? But now has Elohim set the members, every one of them, in the body as it has pleased him? And if they were all one member, where were the body? But now are they many members, yet but one body? And the eye cannot say unto the hand, I have no need of thee, nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. Nay, much more those members of the body which seem be more feeble are necessary. And those members of the body which we think to be less honorable upon these we bestow more abundant honor, and our uncomely parts have more abundant comeliness. For our comely parts have no need, but Elohim has tempered the body together, having given more abundant honor to that part which lacked, that there should be no diversion, no vision, that there be no divisions in the body, but that the members should have the same care for one another. And whether one member suffers, all members suffer with it. Or one member be honored, all the members rejoice with it. Now ye are the body of the Messiah, and the members in particular. And Yahweh has set some in the assembly, first apostles, secondarily prophets, thirdly teachers, after that miracles, then gifts of healing, helps, government, diversities of tongue. Are all apostles, are all prophets, are all teachers, are all workers of miracles? Having all the gifts of healing, do all speak with tongues, do all interpret? But convert earnestly the best gifts, and yet show I unto you a more excellent way. I've read 1 Corinthians, the 12th chapter.
Hallelujah.
For the speaker this morning, I would like to introduce our visitor we have this morning, Marlon Love. And our first speaker this morning will be Marlon Love.
Hello.
Hello.
This is a surprise. Wow. I initially came down to hear what the brothers have here to say. And for some of you that might recognize me more accurately now, I'm Hoshea Love's son.
Right.
As far as who I am. Yeah.
Hoshea Love!
Yeah.
Yeah.
Been around a little while.
Yeah.
Okay.
And it was expressed to me that class is a place to gather together in order to learn about the Heavenly Father. I don't want to say I'm unique in many ways. I attended class for a number of years religiously with my grandmother, Annabelle Allen, which is Fred Allen's mother. So Fred Allen is my uncle. For me, and this is how we have to look at things, you have to get it for yourself, because I'm not going to get it through who I know.
That's right. Right.
And I can't rely on them to be there for me all the time. So I think I come today just to, again, to gather together like the Ames say.
All right.
And to find a place. Like I told Joe when I first walked up, I don't have a home school, if you were, because I've always, class is my school all the time, everywhere I'm at.
Right.
I don't need to come Wednesdays, Thursdays, or because I looked on the online to find the class to come to and to hear, because I know that there's some distinctions of teach in the school now, because I went to, when I did attend school, I attended at LA period of time with Kenley, but I was a babe then. And I don't know, I always listened, I always heard, and I can always understand the division of talk, if you would. I went to LA probably while they had their transition of speak, and I can hear it right away. There's nothing to get up and bash your feet about or hand about. It just, you recognize there's a movement going on, and there's things happening that we have no control of and can't change a lot of times. Just like me, wanting to come down here more readily, more often, the things in my life that I have to do to maintain with what I've instituted for myself. And you have to work through those things with the, hopefully with the understanding that of what you've learned here in class. I've always, to me, I feel that I always try to reason with what I've learned in class. It doesn't leave you. If you're honest with yourself, you have some integrity about yourself. You have to be honest with yourself, number one.
Right.
Otherwise, it doesn't, none of it helps.
Right.
And you have to believe. Mm-hmm. You have to believe what thus saith Yahweh in the book, because it's His Spirit that wrote that book through those men that wrote those scriptures. Mm-hmm. And like I said, I would sort of just give a testimony if I was asked to get up, because it's not my favorite place. Most people don't like to be up, so that's always been a, I know you've been around quite a while, and I remember you dearly, and I know that's one thing, some people, like the scripture says, some people aren't teachers all the time right away, and it doesn't give any less credence as to your part in what you play.
Right.
Because you motivate me when I see you here, and I say, wow, there's something here, whether you say the word or not, or you recognize me initially when I walk through. But So I give you that thanks for giving me some comfort to stay and not turn away.
You're in the right place.
Yeah. It gives another nail in the coffin in the wood. Same thing with Johnny.
Yeah.
It's a surprise. I know him. And it gives me comfort to be here. I got some things to talk to you about still.
But,
and it confirms, and I got to be honest with what I'll have to talk to you about. Because it all plays in, it all comes at different times and different places that I didn't expect. I didn't know what to expect.
Uh-huh.
You know, and that's the part of the faith and the understanding that I have to have some confidence to come and give a testimony. How be it large or how be it small, because it's going to edify somebody in some minute way.
Yeah.
And you know that the smallest part of your body is important.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I'm not looking to expound nothing or I haven't had no fantastic thought of visions or anything. It's just who I am. And if the Father directs and gives me direction and I follow him. I have been. That's why I'm able to come back and able to hear. I'm proud and happy that you guys are here and are doing what you're doing and continuing on with the words, along with the other schools that are of the like minds.
Mm-hmm.
I think with that, I'll say thank you for having me.
Our next speaker will be the dean of the school, Dr. Joe Williams.
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
As always, it's a pleasure and honor to stand before the assembly of Yahshua Messiah and testify of some of the things that Yahweh allowed me to see and understand about this great teaching. We appreciate the Martin Love coming down to study with us. This is my first time meeting him. And I'm also happy that you saw faces to recognize, that you recognize, that actually sparked something in you that make you want to hope it, make you want to come back and study with us. Because what we're doing down here, we're raising up soldiers. Soldiers to preach the death, burial, resurrection of Yahshua Messiah. And what our purpose is to help you find and know Yahweh our Elohim as He really is, as He actually exists, and that is in you. And I want to also encourage you to come to school on a regular basis.
Yeah.
You know, whether it be 3 days, 2 days, whatever you can do, it's important that you be here because you will be a witness, you see, to this teaching, just like these gentlemen are a witness to this teaching all these many years.
That's right.
You see, but what's happened to us is that this image that we've embraced, you see, which we've become through our own theories and our concepts and opinions, that we feel like we have a say or we have a comment or something we want to declare how it is. But what our purpose is to destroy this image that you've embraced since you was a little boy or a little girl, as you sojourn, you see, these many years, you see. And the way we're going to break, destroy that image is with His rock, which is Yahshua Messiah. 1 Colossians 1:12, please.
Colossians 1:12. Giving thanks unto the Father.
Now look, this is the Apostle Paul. This is what we are. Remember, this is our chronology chart, you see, and we know that there was a creative age, you see, and from the fall of Adam, that opened up the antediluvian age, which is the age before the flood, you see, and then that age ended with the flood, and we know that after the flood, you see, there's the postdiluvian age, which is the age after the flood, which ended at the cross. Now what we are in this present kingdom age, you see, or in this age, is the present kingdom age. This is where we sit. Now the Apostle Paul, you see, would walk around the tabernacle in a body in, you see, at the end of the age, you see, of the post-Diluvian age. But he also crossed over into the present kingdom age where we sit. And this is one of the things he said. He says, giving thanks, read,
Unto the Father.
Unto the Father, Yahweh. Read on.
Which has made us meet.
He has made us meet. What does that word mean? See, I always thought, meet somebody means, hey, hi, this is my, how you doing? We meeting each other. That's what I thought the word meet mean. But see, when you come down to the school, we explore, we investigate, and we examine everything. And we find out that this word, meet means to make fit. You see, we have been made fit, suitable, acceptable, to become recipients of the gift of the Holy Spirit, which was dispensed on the day of Pentecost. Let's read, please.
Which has made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the sons of light.
Now listen, what is the inheritance? Well, the inheritance is simple. It is divine intelligence, wisdom and knowledge, beauty, love, justice, foundation, power, and strength, and the power of the resurrection. That is what was dispensed on the day of Pentecost, whereby we, you see, as sons of Yahweh, can come to a profound understanding of Yahweh's divine purpose and His pattern and His plan. That we won't walk around in darkness, in ignorance, and in stupidity, not knowing who we are, thinking that we are more than what we think we are. In other words, we want to destroy this image because this is who we think you are, we are. And then some folks don't know that this is what they are. You see, and what it is a culmination of theory, concepts, and opinions. Corruption. What you believe, what you think, what you feel that really down here nobody cares about. You see, but you. We want to destroy that image, and we want you to put on the whole armor, which is Yahshua Messiah. Form in you so when you walk in the newness of life, knowing who you are. Where you come from, where you're born, where you are within the scheme of things, that when you present yourself as a son of Yahweh, you're not shaking in your boot because you are a soldier, you see, of Yahshua Messiah. And you have been equipped and prepared to preach the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Yahshua the Messiah, whereby you can elevate, raise someone else up from the dead. Read, please. Let's go.
Who have delivered us from the power
now
of darkness.
Now listen, Yahshua, through his death, and through his burial, and through his resurrection, we have all been delivered from the power of darkness. What are you talking about? I'm saying, we are trying to prove the existence, you see, and the destruction of Satan and his angels through the dispensations and ages. You see, and I'm letting you know that you are part of the purpose. And you're going to carry out the purpose, walk around in one of these bodies. You see, we want you to see and understand that if Yahweh brought this purpose down, it's also Him carrying it out through the man. You see, but because of your ignorance and your stupidity and your not knowing and thinking you know, you see, you have put on this image, you see, of I'm Joe. I'm Muhammad Ali. I'm Donald Trump. I'm the president. I'm the pope. You follow what I'm saying? And whoever you think, even the Crips and the Little Bloods over there, they think they got something going on. They have no problem around shooting at everybody. Mm-hmm. Until you start shooting back. Once you start shooting, you follow what I'm saying? So what we're doing right now, we're equipping you to shoot back. You see, and when you're going to shoot back, you know what you're going to preach? You're going to preach Yahshua the Messiah, the son of the living Elohim. And embrace him in your heart and in your mind and destroy the image that you have become. Let's read, please.
Who have delivered us from the power of darkness.
Read on.
And have translated us into
the kingdom. We have been translated into the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah. That's what we've been translated to. Mm-hmm. Whereby ignorance is not governance. We're not being governed by darkness. You see, what we think, what we feel, we've been governed by Yahshua Messiah. Not this one on the cross,
right,
but this one here that has been elevated.
Yeah.
You see, I'm talking about the spirit of the Elohim that is formed in you, that speaks to you on a constant, regular basis, but because of our ignorance and because of who we think we are and how proud we are, you follow me, walking up, you follow what I'm saying? Look at me. You see, you know what I mean? It takes a real stone to bring you down. You see, and nice thing about Yahweh, he will let you know that he is Yahweh. Mm-hmm. You see, there is no question about that. He'll let you know that. You see, read on, please. Come on.
In whom we have redemption through his blood.
And who we, in this perfect kingdom age, I'm talking about us, being Gentiles, we have redemption through Yahshua Messiah getting up on that cross and dying the death of an outcast dog. Let's read on, please.
Even the forgiveness of sin.
Even all those skeletons that you're harboring, and we all got them. Come on, you know we do.
Yeah.
Even those skeletons we got, I'm talking about from the top to the bottom. I'll start with me first. I got a few that I will never, ever reveal. I'll just die with it, but you get the point. I've been forgiven for it, but you know, I don't need forgiveness from you. Mm-hmm. I just need it from him and make sure I don't do it again. Okay. Whatever that is. Yeah. But we all have skeletons. Oh, yeah. Every last one of us. Uh-huh. You see? And, and it plagues us. You see? Now, I can, let's just hypothetically. I don't drink or smoke, but I ain't condemning nobody who does. Mm-hmm. But let's say I was a drunk. You see, ain't nothing wrong with drinking and smoking. But my goodness, man, don't get drunk and hurt everybody. But once I've overcome being a drunk through my 12-step program, I can take that and bring somebody else up. Do you understand what I'm saying? And you can use this gospel to show how it helped you get from darkness into the light. That's what I'm talking about. But you ain't got to come up in here, you know, pouring out all your skeletons to us, because we don't care. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You ain't been to class for 25, 30 years, you know what? We just happy that you're here.
Right.
They got what I was doing, I don't give a damn what you was doing. I'm happy that you found your way back. Yeah. And that something held on to you, bring you on up in here. Right. That's what we're talking about. Because now somebody can look at you and see how you walk, and you know what? They're going to come follow you now. Because what's he going back up in there for? The only reason this man right here is here. Talk about Reggie. And you know why? One of his brothers from Pomona was coming for 2 or 3 years. Then what the hell is she learning over there? What's she going over there? That's why he's here. That's why he came. Looking at her, and she came and listened. She got strong too. But anyway, let's move on. Let's read on, please.
Who is the image of the invisible El?
Now listen, Yahshua Messiah, he is the image of the invisible El, you see, which is Yahweh Elohim, you see, himself. Remember, Yahweh is spirit, and spirit is divine intelligence, wisdom and knowledge, beauty, love, justice, foundation, power, strength. That is what spirit is. And the founder said this, that Yahweh is the source of intelligence. The source of wisdom and knowledge and beauty and love and justice and foundation, power, and strength. You see, that's what he is, yet Yahweh abides therein. Consequently, and therefore, we have a cloud, you follow me, that goes all around the edges of the chart to show you that everything on this chart abides within the cloud. To show you that everything in the universe, barring none, you see, abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Even the angelic host, which is also a part of the universe. Because see, through our ignorance, we think, and I know I did, you see, that the physical creation was the universe. Mm. And funny thing, some folks still do. But the universe has two counterparts.
Right.
It is the angelic and the physical creation. That is what makes up the universe. That abides within the pure spirit state or spirit law itself. And the witness is that you presented yourself here. See, you have a physical body, but you also have an inner man. And that inner man abides within the realm of eternity because you have an inner man and you also have a physical body. But it walks within the realm of eternity. And just like Yahweh, see, Yahweh cannot get outside of himself to look back on himself. Because he is all of that and anything else you come up with. You see, he's the ultimate source, the substance, the limits, the bounds, the origin, and the essence of all things, but not some things. You see, and see, by him being all of that, talking about the essence of all things, he is also both masculine and feminine within himself. What does that mean? That makes Yahweh himself the parent substance. Therefore, for, it is him who can give birth to anything that you see and that you don't see, that is known, that is unknown, that is animate or inanimate. I'm talking about Yahweh himself. Everything, it emanates from this cloud or from Yahweh. Keep reading. Let me have Isaiah 46, 9 and 10.
Who is the image of the invisible
Elohim? He is the image of the invisible Elohim. Read on.
The first cause of all creation.
Now wait a minute. It says that Yahweh Elohim is the first cause of what?
All creation.
All creation. Now, King James says the firstborn of all creation. Holy Name says first cause of all creation. So in that Yahweh Elohim is the first cause or the firstborn of all creation. Sorry, but also this boy right here, Lucifer, he also gave birth to him too.
Right.
You follow me?
Yeah.
Created him too. And when he created him, everybody got him all scared of him. Don't have a clue what a devil is. Mm-hmm. Don't have no idea how a devil operates. Mm-hmm. Think it's something gruesome and ugly. Yeah. But just, I ain't gonna put it on nobody else. The devil looks just like me. Mm-hmm. Just like me. Maybe act like me and maybe even better than me. You see? Because all those popes, I'm talking about all those cardinals and those bishops, was molesting those little boys in church. I'm telling you, those parents sent their kids to church, you see, in good intent for their kids to learn about God. They had no idea that when they go into the toilet thing, the confession booth, he's talking about, I got some feelings. The Pope said, oh, okay, I got me one here. You have no idea what's going on in his head.
Yeah.
That's deception, folks.
Yeah.
You see, the point is, he's in the seat of position. In other words, he is sitting on the seat of authority in the church. And let me just go right over here. In other words, by him sitting in the pulpit on the seat of authority, he has the ability to deceive, you see, those who don't know, as tossed to and fro from every wind of doctrine. Because he is dressing the part, he is walking the part, he is acting the part, and you know what? We got him up here. Mm-hmm. You see, and when we put him up here, that's the image that you've received in your mind. Uh-huh. And what we want to do is to destroy that image with that rock, and that's with the truth. Alright? Let's read on, please.
Isaiah 46.
No, I haven't gained through with that yet. I'm not finished with Colossians yet.
For by him,
by Yahweh Elohim, read on.
Were all things created.
All things were created, not some. It was created. Read on.
That are in heaven.
Read on.
And that are in earth.
Read on.
Visible and invisible.
Read on.
Whether they be thrones or dominions,
uh-huh,
or principalities or powers.
Uh-huh.
All things were created by him and for him.
That's good enough right there. Now Isaiah. Now look. Thank goodness we got a founder who came in and loved us. You see. And Yahweh manifesting their body. See, there is a purpose. There is a purpose. There is also a pattern on which that purpose is going to be carried out. But there's also a plan. The three P's. You see? A purpose, a pattern, and a plan. You see? Yahweh is going to carry out his purpose. Now this is the $64,000. I mean, this is the mystery. I didn't even know there was a purpose in the first place. Had no clue that there was a purpose. This school taught me that there was a purpose.
Yeah.
And there's a pattern. And there's a plan. Me, I don't know, but I think I know. Because I have embraced the ways of the world. You see? Now, that serpent coming out of there, like it or not, that is a man. You see? And that's what puts the man in position to deceive. You see? Because we call him, oh, he's just a snake in the grass.
Mm-hmm.
Don't look like no snake.
Oh, yeah.
You see? But he's a snake in the grass. Hold it right there real quick. Pick up 2 Corinthians, I think I want 11. Maybe 2 or 3. And jump down to it. What I want? That's exactly what I want.
2 Corinthians 11 and 3.
That's what I want. And then we're going to jump down to 11.
But I fear, lest by any means.
That's it.
As the serpent beguiled
Eve. As the serpent beguiled Eve. Now we're looking at the woman Eve. We keep looking at the woman Eve. And look, whoever illustrated this, I mean, they got a good looking woman up here too, you hear me? Look, as the serpent beguiled Eve, but what you don't see, you too are the woman.
Right.
And you also have been beguiled and been deceived. By who? By your pastor. Mm-hmm. This is what we do. We got to get an offer. We got to get a love offering for the pastor. Yeah. We got to get a building fund for the church. Yeah. You follow me? Yeah. We got to also have another fund for the land. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, well, well. But we also... You got to also donate. We got the choir. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You see? And nowadays, you know, they hold you accountable. If you say you're going to pay, you sign your name because you're so happy. Guess what? They hold you accountable. No. Say, wait up. We know you ain't been here. Where's your donations? You follow what I'm saying? Because now you got him all puffed up. You see? Because of the image that you've created within your consciousness. Whoever it is. You see? But let's read, please.
As a serpent beguiled Eve.
As a serpent beguiled Eve. Read on.
His subtlety.
Now listen. Some people used to say, well, Eve was not deceived. Listen, damn it, she was deceived.
Yeah.
And the reason why I know she's deceived because you are. Mm-hmm. And you are the woman. And let me say this. Lucifer, or the devil, he's a woman too. Mm-hmm. How do I know that? He's an angel just like every last one of them. You understand? He is an angel too. Uh-huh. In other words, he is also created by Yahweh himself. Mm-hmm. And listen. Lucifer is not a liability. He's an asset for us. You see? Y'all seen that movie, that Tyler Perry movie where the guy was beating up the diary of a mad black woman?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And the lady was getting beat up, so it was being mistreated. Mm-hmm. And then she finally met a nice guy. She said, you know what? If I hadn't known, she said, I don't know what it's like to feel so good. I'm not sure to trust him either. Because if I hadn't seen such mistreatment, I wouldn't be able, I'm having difficulty appreciating this.
Right.
You see, because she never been treated nice before. She's worried. You know what I mean? You see, well, that's how they were saved, you know, like it was brought out a couple of weeks ago. We all have DNA. Now the question is, what DNA are you bringing down? Some folks, they're the family musicians. All those kind of, everybody in the family playing instrument. Some folks, you know, they're athletes. You know, they breed quarterbacks or basketball players. Some people breed poets. Mm. But also, some families, the whole family is gangsters. Uh-huh. I mean, all the way down to the kids. They walk around with a swagger too. You follow what I'm saying? Next thing you know, everybody in the whole city know about this family. Because they all gangsters. Mm. Now, there's a family out there in Panorama City called Blunts. Everybody heard about the Blunts. You go anywhere in the San Fernando Valley, you mention the Blunts, everybody know the Blunts.
Right.
They ain't nothing. You heard about the Blunts too?
I just live in
the corner. They gangsters. Mm-hmm. You heard their name before? The Blunts? Yes, everybody heard about the Blunts. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because that's what they do. So, somebody say, I'm so-and-so Blunt, you can go. We ain't had nothing to do with you. Don't want no problem with the Blunts. Mm-hmm. The whole family, just, that's the DNA. Mm-hmm. You see, and the DNA we're trying to breed, we're trying to give birth to, is Yahshua Messiah. You see, the son of the living Elohim, you see, that being formed in you. You see, but I got to make my point. I want to move on. Read, please.
But I fear lest by any means as a serpent beguiled Eve.
Read on.
In his subtlety, so your mind should be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Yahshua.
Now see, the first speaker said that today. He didn't say it like that, but it was real crystal clear. That it was what he used to. So he heard the divisions. Because it was imbued from when he was a little boy. You see, he didn't know, he know what the founder taught, he heard. But it's the division. You can hear. As soon as he walked, he can hear the division. You see? Because see, the gospel, by definition, is the death, the burial, the resurrection, the ascension, and the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. That is what the gospel is. You see? And it was through Yahweh, you see, who is the parent of substance, who gave birth to his son, Yahweh Elohim. And Yahweh Elohim, in part, manifesting in a physical body. In other words, this is Yahweh in his sonship degree. You see, and him manifested in a physical body is Yahshua Messiah, which is the name of the Holy Spirit. Then, at the point in time, you see, he died, he buried, he resurrection, ascended to the Father, you see, and then pouring his Spirit back out on the hearts and minds of men, whereby now we have, I'll put it like this, death have no dominion over us. Deception has no dominion over us. Why? Because the rock, you see, has shattered the image. You see, and the image that has been shattered is what you think about the Bible, what the soul is. You see, fear. You see, what I believe, how I feel, corruption. You see, that's what's been shattered through his death, his burial, and his resurrection. I'm pointing to a stone because, see, we can see a rock. If we put a man there, you wouldn't think it's a rock. But the rock is symbolic of Yahshua Messiah, who is the rock. You see, that is only one that is capable of shattering the image, if you will. Read, please.
For he that cometh preaches another Yahshua.
Read on.
Whom we have not preached.
Now look. We're going to stop right there. You're going to jump down to 11 just a second. Now, the Yahshua is being preached. Is that Henry Clifford Kelly is your Savior. You're saved in his name. And, you know, yeah, I said it. You follow me? And yeah, we taping. It's not news where I stand on that. You are not saved in Henry Clifford Kelly's name. Never have, never will, and he's not either.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And I hear folks talking about, and Dr. Kelly came down. Mm-hmm. Kelly came no damn where. He's in the same position we in.
Right.
And let me say this, all the rest of them too.
Right.
Who think we gotta come to you to get it? You can be home alone by yourself. Yahweh will reveal something to you.
Right.
Why? Because you too are a son of Yahweh. That is, if you embrace the principle or if you believe the report. I'm talking about the death, burial, resurrection, or do you believe the witnesses? Which is him, the spirit, the water, blood, that's in you. You see? But let's read, please.
Wherefore, because I love you not, Yahweh knoweth. But what I do...
I'm going to jump down to 11.
That is 11.
Okay, then jump on down to 13 then, I won't.
13. For such are false apostles.
There you go, such are false apostles. I should have went to that first, huh? Read on.
Deceitful workers.
Deceitful workers.
Transforming themselves into the apostles.
Transforming themselves into the apostles of Yahshua Messiah. In other words, my point is, these stiffy, jack-legged preachers, the Pope, and you too, while I'm at it, you see, have the ability to transform into an angel of light. Somebody said, what you said, what you talking about me too? You know damn well you lied at least once or twice in your life. And if you lied, you transformed into an angel of light. I didn't do it. You know I didn't do it. Don't lie to your boss. Don't lie to your boss. You know that. Y'all seen that movie 12 Years of Slavery? Mm-hmm. Oh. Y'all see that movie?
Yes.
There's a scene in there. I'm a quote. The scene was this guy who was a free man up in New York. Mm-hmm. Had a family, everything. Very wealthy, well-to-do, dressed well. Black man, played the fiddle. But in those days, what they would do, they would get well-educated slaves, nice beefy guy, and then they would sell them down to the South. They got him drunk, offered him some money, and next thing you know, he's in slavery for 12 years. But there's a scene where he wanted to get out. And so there was a white guy who came in, and he wanted to let him know, I gotta get out of here, I'm a free man, I can write, I'm educated. Couldn't let him know he's educated. So what he did was, he was going to get this guy to take the letter to somebody so he can be free, which eventually happened. But the guy wanted a job on the plantation, so he ratted him out. So the slave owner comes out and say, can you read and write, boy? He said, no, boss. I can't write. He said, well, so-and-so say, he's the boss, he just wants your job, he just wants a job here, that's all you want. You know I would never do nothing like that for you. My point is, he had to do that for survival.
Yeah.
You see, nevertheless, it's a lie. That's the point I'm trying to say.
Right.
You see, and we all have done that. We've lied, we've been lied too. And I'm letting you know, when you lie, you transform into an angel of light.
There ain't no other way around. If anybody can challenge that, we okay with that. But the point is, that's what you're doing. You're manifesting satanic principles. You see, and that's all it is. But I just don't want to put it on the Pope, and put it on the neighbor, and put it on the friend. I'm a pastor. I gotta throw you into the pit too. Me too. You see, because I've lied and I've been lied too. You see, but the point is, that's how we grow and that's how we learn.
Right.
You see, but the fact of the matter is that we know how to repent through the rock, which is Yahshua Messiah. You see, not that he's going to continue to forgive you for what you do and what you don't do, but what it does is strip you. And look, there's something in you that condemns you, you see, that is manifested on the cosmic screen of your consciousness. And I'm telling you, that's Yahshua Messiah. It ain't you. And when you do wrong, good, bad, or indifference, you know what? Something says, you know you're wrong, Job. You know that ain't right. You know you shouldn't have done that. And everybody had that experience. At least in here they do. You follow what I'm saying? It's just the way it is. And you know why? Because you are a threefold universal spirit pattern right where you sit. You are a manifestation of Yahweh himself right where you sit. With an immutable spirit abiding there in you, carrying out the purpose and plan of Yahweh from start to finish. You see? I got to, now I think I'm done with that. Okay? Now, Isaiah. I think I took too long with that. Let's go. Let's read.
Isaiah 46, 9, and 10.
Mm-hmm.
Remember the former things of old.
Now, I'll get back to this. There's the purpose, and there's the pattern, and there's the plan. So remember what Isaiah said. Remember what Moses said. Remember what the prophet said. Remember what Abraham said. Remember the former things of old. Read on.
For I am Elohim.
You see? Read on.
And there is none else.
Now some folks might have a heart. There is none else. There is no such thing as a you and a Yahweh. Never has been, never will be. The question is, why is that? Because Yahweh is the ultimate source. You see, the substance, the limits, and the bounds, and the origin, and the essence of all things, not some things. You see, and it was Yahweh that gave birth to his son. And when he was the son, or when he stepped down, I'll say it like this. When Yahweh took on a shape and form, you see, him, in that shape and that form, is a declaration of what Yahweh declared in the realm of eternity. And when he took on that shape and form, that is an execution of the purpose and what he declared. So therefore, I'm trying to get you to see the Yahweh purpose. He conceived, you see, he fulfilled, you see, and he consummated the entire purpose right before he set it in motion. So everything has to be made manifest exactly the way that he said, you see. And that is what he purposed and declared. But what Yahweh Elohim did not do, he did not reach back into pure spirit and create the creation outside him. That is just absolutely not so. You don't even do that. And if you do, tell me so I can do it. Because I'd like to know how to do that too. But the point, that ain't so. You see, and listen, if that was the case, then he would have done that with Eve. See, when Yahweh drew the woman out of Eve, I mean drew the woman out of the man Adam, if he chose to, he could have created the woman the very same way he created Adam.
Right.
But if he did that, then he showed forth another source. Mm-hmm. So he went right back in Adam and drew the woman out to show forth the oneness of Yahweh. How that Eve was immersed in Adam. And Adam was inundated in the earth. And the earth was inundated in Elohim, or in the water, you see. And that was inundated in Elohim, and Elohim inundated in pure spirit. Just take it all the way back. So he's showing forth the oneness, you see, and right where you sit are your children, their children, their children, and their children, and immersed right in the same one. And that's exactly how that works. Yahweh running the show through the man, Adam, if you will. But read on, please.
I am Elohim. And there is none
like me. There is none like me who can declare the end right from the beginning. Let's read on. I got a jet. Read.
Declaring the end from the beginning.
Read on.
And from ancient times, the things that are not yet done.
In other words, we ain't talking about having no Yahweh emergencies, if you will. You see? Read on, please.
Saying, My counsel shall stand.
Now he says, my counsel, what I declare in the realm of eternity, that shall stand. Read on, please.
And I will do all my
I'm going to do whatever I purpose in the realm of eternity. Come on.
Calling the eagle from the east.
Read on.
The man that executeth my counsel.
In other words, the eagle is Yahshua the Messiah. Mm-hmm. You see? And that's why the E is in Elohim. Because Elohim did put on a body. You see, and the eagle is king of the bird kingdom. You see, and of course, you know the lion, you see, is the king of the beast. You see, and then the O represents the ox because it is Yahshua who's carrying our burdens. But he is the man, you see, that's running the show. Let's read, please. Come on.
Yea, I have spoken.
He said, I have spoken it back in our eternity. Read on.
And I will bring it to pass.
And as soon as you take on shape and form, that is an execution of my purpose. And listen, when he came out of that cloud, or when he come from behind the veil, of inscrutability, if you will. It is Yahweh Elohim that is manifesting in every cosmographical structure of the universe, including the man himself. In other words, it was Yahweh Elohim who took up residence in the man called Adam, and then the man became a living soul. But if you can see that, then you should be able to see that when Yahweh Elohim took up residence in the man called Adam, can't you see that the purpose is now encouched within the man? And then the purpose has to come right on down. You see, down to the genealogies and the pedigrees. Okay? Which gonna take me to a word I really want to talk about. Keep reading.
I have purpose.
I purpose it.
And I will also do it.
I will also do it. Now, let's pick up the three trips in the mountain. Three trips to the mountain. That's this 19th chapter. Now look, not like we smart down here. It was the founder that showed us how to go through this and accept this thing, God. And the only thing we're doing is carrying out the purpose as he drew it out. That's all we're doing. Now, the importance of the three trips in the mountain is really simple. Remember, we have a pattern, is that right? And that pattern, you see, in the most holy place, the holy place, and the court round about. You see, three furnishings in the most holy place, three furnishings in the holy place, and three furnishings in the court round about. You see, now there's three compartments, but there's seven steps in this tabernacle. The gate is one, the altar of sin sacrifice is two, the laver is three, where the washing take place. The door, you see, is four, where at the door there's a cup of holy anointing on, where the high priest was anointed himself before, or anointed before he could officiate in the holy place, in the most holy place. In the holy place, in his vessels, you have the seven bright golden lampstand, the table of shewbread with 12 loaves on it, and then the altar of incense, which is a five-sided structure. You see, not a four-sided, because it also lines up to your lungs to have five lobes to your respiratory system or to your lungs here. Nevertheless, you see, that's coming to the holy place. Now at the door, there's a veil there, which is the first departmental veil, which is blue, purple, and scarlet. Likewise, you see, there's a second veil, which is the second departmental veil, you see, which is also blue, purple, and scarlet. So the fifth step in your tabernacle is the holy place itself and all its contents, you see. But the sixth step in your tabernacle is this second departmental veil. And that's the one that's causing us a problem. Yeah. Now, pick up the textbook real quick. And I think I want page 68, I think, or where it talks about the third day, because I want to make a comment about these veils, and then I want to move on. I could just say it, but I want you to read it.
First volume, page 68.
Where it's talking about the third, is it the third day?
3 days after the slaying of the Paschal lamb, the Israelites came into, or resurrected into the wilderness or holy place. Just as the priest entered into the sanctuary or holy place,
mm-hmm.
and as Yahshua raised from the dead,
read on.
3 days after his crucifixion,
read please.
The wilderness of Sinai represents the holy place in the migratory pattern.
Mm-hmm.
Herein, the Israelites received the manna from heaven, and then the Ten Commandment law in the divine pattern of the tabernacle during the total time of their sojourn therein. They were led by the phenomenal
hold
law it. By day.
Hold on. Let me check. Too much reading right now. What I want
the third day.
The third paragraph. I think that's what I want. where it talks about the veils do two things. They conceal.
It's the third day.
It's the third day?
It's the third day. The section that explains the third day.
Oh, you're way over here. Let me get back over here. You too far over. Here you are. Second page 62, last paragraph.
Volume 1, page 62.
Yeah, that's what I want. You're way over in the sixth day. That's fine being over there.
The second veil, dividing the holy place.
Now look, the second veil. Now, oh man. Yahweh, see, Dr. Killing set this thing up real good. See, we're ignorant. We're in darkness. He got seat. Oh, there's so much. Let me say this. You see this little section right here? You see? Moses is in the cloud. And we got Yahweh up here within the cloud, transforming into a tabernacle. Now, if you just take that little excerpt and take it over here, this is supposed to be a cloud. It's a dark cloud, but it's a cloud, just in case. You see? And then it says, the man in the image of Elohim by the pattern of the tabernacle. Then Yahweh, or Dr. Kinley, he set up the tabernacle pattern here, which was revealed to the man Moses back here, you see, in the world of Sinai. Instituting, you see, and setting up, you see, the true original pattern, who gonna pour his spirit out in the hearts and mind of man, which is Yahweh Elohim. We got right here in the chart, Elohim, the archetype, or the original pattern of the universe. In other words, Yahweh Elohim is the original tabernacle, he's also the original temple. So if you take that part out and you put it over here, you got Yahweh Elohim, you see, transformed to a tabernacle. And then you got the man who is also the creation. You see, this is the anatomy. But then he also showed forth the effects. You got cause, you got effects, you got anatomy, you got physiology. He showed forth the man, in other words, the inner workings, you see, of the man being threefold. Having the most holy place, a holy place, and a court roundabout to line up with the court roundabout, you see, the holy place and the most holy place. Head, chest, abdominal region. Lining up as drums, just like climbing a ladder. But you notice here, see, this second veil, or this most holy place, is lined up to the head region. You see, the holy place is lined up to your chest region, and the court roundabout is lined up to, of course, the court roundabout. You see, or your abdominal region. Then he took this tabernacle, took this plate here, which we call, you see, the Moses chart, and he's showing forth a migratory pattern, and he showed forth that there's darkness down here, you see, and that there was a sacrifice that was down here with the land, with the children of Israel, and that they slaughtered that lamb, you see, or they killed that lamb, or sacrificed that lamb, in order that they might get out. You see, nevertheless, coming on over here, you also sacrifice all your flesh. I'm talking about the chickens, the cows, and the pigs, the possum, whatever you eat, vegetables, it all goes into your abdominal tract or your digestive system. You follow me? But there they concentrate. My point is the death, folks. That's my point. And that food that you have, you see, is digested or it is taken down where you can absorb it into your body. Likewise, that's what's going on right here. You see, but my point is I want to line up talk about this place, the most holy place. Now, you got a veil there. You said you got a veil here, and you got a veil here. Now, if you look at the man, he has a cranium. But what you have here, you know, you see the brain itself. And its convolutions, if you will. You see, which is made up of gray and white matter. You see, and listen. This cloud here lines up to the cloud that is sitting on the seat of authority. Remember, this is the mercy seat, and there's two archangels, Michael and Gabriel. Michael the warrior, Gabriel the messenger, and then you have the mercy seat. And inside the mercy seat, of course, you have the table of stone, which is also brought out the other night, Aaron's rod, the butter, and a pot of manna.
Sure. I just need you to pause. Just stand perfectly still.
The pot of manna, you see. Now in that you found a pot of manna inside, you see, of the Ark of the Covenant, you see. Now, those table of stones lines up with your pituitary gland. Right. Where you have an anterior and posterior pituitary gland. You have seven on one side and three on the other. And what the pituitary gland does, it determines or it declares who you are, what you're going to be. It's the master gland of the body. In other words, it secretes hormones. like thyroxine coming from your thyroid gland. Right. You see, that helps regulate the minerals and the calcium that's in your body, regulate your hunger, things of that nature. And then you have things like the follicle stimulating hormone, which is for the woman where she drops the egg and things of that. But the point is, that master gland determines whether you're going to have a big nose, a little nose, big ears, little ears, red eyes, green eyes, blue eyes, black eyes, color. You get my point? Big feet, little feet. That's what the master gland does, because it governs the body. Likewise, so does that law right there. You see? And then that rod, Aaron's rod of butter. Remember, Aaron was the first high priest. You see? And Yahweh is so cold. It's a setup. It's a fixed bite. He already knew he gonna pick Aaron. But you know what? Just to shut you up. So you won't have nothing to say, comment about it. You know what he did? He said, listen, we're gonna call one elder for each one of the tribe. And everybody gonna bring their arms and gonna put it at the east side of the gate, of the tabernacle.
Right.
You see? And the one that bud almonds first, that's gonna be the priest. Now everybody's alright with that, because that seemed like it's fair. But y'all already know you're gonna pick Aaron. Right. And guess what? They come out the next day, Aaron rides and buddy. Yeah. But my point is, he already knew. He already knew he's gonna pick Aaron. Mm-hmm. And listen, Moses technically is the first high priest, because it was Moses who taught Aaron how to be a high priest.
Right.
Because it was Joshua the son of Nun telling him what to do and how to run the show. You see? But the point is, Moses was still the front man, you see, running the show, because he's the type of Yahshua Messiah, and carrying out the Aaronite priesthood. My point is simply this. These veils do two things. They either conceal or they reveal. You see, and you have a cranium that is covering your head, you see, or covering your brain. You see, and you need a skillful surgeon to know how to go in, crack that brain open, do surgery, and put it back and make everything be all
right.
Can't be like Eve. See, Eve thought she could go in the garden, eat that fruit, and everything gonna be all right. And when she ate it, everything was not all right. But she thought she could eat it, and everything gonna be all right. You see, but now it involved Adam. Now he had to eat, because he had to take responsibility for his bride. But the point is, because we are the bride, like unto Eve, we are subject to vanity. And by being subject to vanity, we got a problem. You see, because we're subject to all the ways of the world. You see, and we create this image. But it was Yahweh that's running the show, you see, that is setting this thing up. Because it's him that is sitting on the seat of authority, running the show. You see, so what happens is that when the veil is up, you have no idea that you're Yahweh. You have no clue you're Yahweh. You think you're sharing. And by you thinking that you're sharing, you feel like you can do whatever you want to do. Because this is me. This is how I feel, what I think, what I believe. You see? We all do it. You see? Oh, I was listening to so-and-so-and-so-and-so. He said this, so-and-so-and-so-and-so-and-so-and-so. You see? But you know what? I'm not sure about this, I'm not sure about that. But the point is, the way that it is, you want to hear what this one right here say. You want to know what thus said Yahweh. You want to know what thus said Yahweh Elohim. And when that happened, the veil comes down. You see, and when the veil comes down, then you're in a position to receive. I'll give you an example. Some people have difficulties falling in love and being in love and expressing themselves. Why? Because some people feel like if I let my shield down, then I'm being weak. You follow what I'm saying?
Uh-huh.
I want to be strong. But it takes more strength to take your heart and put it on the table and put it out there than to shield it and cover it, because you don't want to get hurt. But we got mental scars from history. You get my point? Because we learned that we can't just trust everybody. You follow what I'm saying? But the point is, you got to put that door, that veil got to come down. The shield got to come down. Otherwise, folks say, nobody loves me. Well, hell, who have you tried to love? I have no friend. Who have you tried to be friends? You want everybody to be friends, and you be friend you, but you don't want to be friends with nobody. You want everybody to love you, but you don't want to love nobody. You want to take, but you don't want to give. You want to receive, but you don't want to give. You get my point? You see, and you know why? It's because of this image, man. I'm sorry. It's just because of this image that you've embraced in your heart and in your mind. You see, nevertheless.
You see, those veils got to come down. And when those veils come down in the school, we want them to come down so we can show you something about Yahweh and His purpose. Because we know that you've been deceived. And that you also deceived yourself. We want you to look at who you are and what you become and show you where you're going and what you're going to put on. And what you want to put on is that coat, that armor, which is Yahweh Messiah in you. That's what you want to put on. You want to put on divine intelligence, wisdom and knowledge, beauty, love, justice, foundation, and power and strength, so you can stand in the wiles of the adversary. That when you present yourself as a living sacrifice, you know what? You have no problem standing alone. Because Yahweh is running the show. I'm hoping, trust you guys, I got something out of this. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Our next speaker this afternoon will be Dr. Will Williams.
Good afternoon, class.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon.
I was enjoying myself back there. I was gonna say, so did I see your hand?
Yeah. You are one of you.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I know. Yeah, one of my Medusa snake dreads, you know, sometimes want to choke me. Glad to be here. Glad to see you here, brother. I just met you for the first time, but that's okay, man. You're in a good place, man. And I've been like you a lot of times. I've left class and did things, you know, and you know, stuff like that. And some dastardly things, actually, you know. I mean, I remember Joseph, he wanted some secrets to go to the grave, you know. He's like, I got a few too, you know. Yeah, I know. I almost went to federal prison once. I don't like to think about that. But anyway, but I thank Yahweh for His deliverance and good mercies. Otherwise, I would not be able to stand before you here today. Okay. Continuing on with some of the things that were said. My thing is simply this. And this is what I'm beginning to understand more and more. That what's on these charts, and we say it all the time, but it's just become, how Dr. Kelly would put it, when you learn more about this doctrine, when you understand it more, things get brighter and brighter. Mm-hmm. You know, that's the term we use. And if I learned anything after all this time, is that you have to engage this vision. See, it's more to it than just standing up here and we make correlations. You really got to get into these charts. And when I say that, I'm talking about the vision. What's illustrated on here is a divine vision and a revelation, see, given by Yahweh Himself. And you know, and it's amazing because we claim and we tout that this, we have the proof for the existence of Yahweh, see, that we can prove His existence. In fact, that's the aim of our class, to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as He really is and actually exists. So for us to make a claim like that, that would say that, you know, well, we got something here that could show you that we would hope would convince you of His existence. Mm-hmm. Now, I've met folks, I mean, I've been in this a long time, you know, 40 years exactly. And, you know, and I've had people, in fact, I ran into a couple of folks, you know, that I knew early on in class that they left and now they're agnostic. And, you know, it scratches my head. I'm like, how can you be agnostic after being exposed to this? You know, or for that matter, how can you go back to church or go back to any other thing after really being exposed to this and being convinced of this, you know? I was telling Joe earlier, just before class starts, that you know, I mean, I left class the first time, you know, I've been out for a couple of years, but I didn't want to go back to church. I was staying home with my parents, and my mom, she, you know, I mean, in her mind, she knew that I had problems with this branch, you know, but in her mind, it was like, oh, well, son, you know, Jesus will make it all better. Right. Mm-hmm. You know, that was her thing about it, you know, and she's going to try to sit down and talk to me, you know. And I'm like, Mom, you know, I understood this much. I said, look, the branch school was messed up, you know, where I was at was messed up, but the doctrine that I learned, that I read out of this book, and I have my textbook, that I read out of this book, I ain't gonna find, I have no problem with that. Mm-hmm. So for you to sit up and try to tell me that I should go back to church and find Jesus is really, it's not a very smart thing for you to say. In fact, I went on to tell her that in that same moment that, look, I renounce Christianity. You know, in other words, I give it up. I ain't coming back to it. It's in the dump, whatever you want to say. You know, I've moved on from it. And no matter whatever happens to me here, I will never, ever go back to Christianity. Mm-hmm. Ever. Or any other religion, for that matter. I have friends, you know, I know people that have been in class, and they've gone other to other religions now. You know, after being in this class, and I scratched my head, and I wondered, and I said, now what was it that, I mean, first you were convinced this was the gospel. Now my question is, what unconvinced you?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know? And it just makes me think of Hebrews, the 6th chapter. See? And because if anything that I've learned is that what this doctrine does, it makes you self-sufficient. Or it, put it like this. It makes you self-assured that your sufficiency is in Yahweh. Mm-hmm. That's what makes, you know, that's the thing. And so therefore, for me, you know, I mean, whenever I got, you know, I was out of class and I was, you know, I didn't like, well, maybe I'll go to church and sit down and let, you know, pray. It never even crossed my mind. Because that's what, like the first speaker said, you can have class at home. Mm-hmm. You know, and that's what the scripture says. See, seek your husband at home. You know, okay? Read.
Hebrews 6:1. Therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of the Messiah, let us go on unto perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works.
Now, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works. These are the dead works. See, and we went through this in our last workshop. See, it's these dead works. See, it's what captures the world. These dead works, these carnal ordinances. And see, when I say carnal ordinances, it's not just exactly these 613. Though, I'll tell you, these are very prevalent. Because when you stop and think about it, this is embraced by most of Christianity. And Christianity is like 2 billion people, which is one-third of the planet. Okay? Yeah. But see, the carnal ordinances doesn't necessarily have to be these specific 613 ordinances. A carnal ordinance is any law based on a carnal concept.
Very good.
Give you a case in point. We got baptism here. Yahweh told the Israelites in the 613 ordinances about baptism. Now, the second speaker went into the principle of baptism, that it existed long before it was codified in these 613 ordinances. Right. And another thing, the Gentiles, they practice their own form of water baptism as well. Like the Hindus, they have this ritual where like a million Hindus go and bathe, ritually bathe in the Ganges River. I forget what the festival is, but they do it every year. Now, it's a water baptism. The thing about it is, Yahweh didn't tell them to do that. They did that on their own volition. See? Based on their own, that was their own personal carnal ordinance that they put on their own people. See? Okay? So now, that's, again, this is what got the world in, because see, carnal ordinances, see, restored. See, that's what Satan did. Let's finish this out now. Get to my point.
Not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and the faith toward Yahweh.
See, not laying again the foundation. Satan is laying again the foundation. See, carnal ordinances restored.
Yeah.
So now, if we're not laying the foundation, then who is? He is. That's what he's laying the foundation of.
Mm-hmm.
See? And that's all part of this human government thing. But read.
Of the doctrine of baptisms, and of laying on of hands, and of resurrection of the dead, and of eternal judgment.
Mm-hmm.
And this will we do if Yahweh permits.
Now, this is what we're going to do if Yahweh permits. In other words, we're going to put all this aside. And we're going to go to him by faith. That is to say, we have received grace through faith.
Mm-hmm.
The Abrahamic promise. This was a dispensation of faith. We got a line here. And this is where grace was dispensed.
There you go.
First on the day of Pentecost. and then 7 years later extended to the Gentiles. And that grace is still being dispensed to this day as we speak through faith. Mm-hmm. Because we are a recipient of the promise given to a man, Abraham. And he didn't have to do any works. He wasn't given a set of works to do. He just believed the witnesses that Yahweh made manifested in his life, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. And that same promise has been extended first to the Jews, now to the rest of us. No different, okay? But the devil will say, no, no, it's not like that. You got to go get dunked in the water. You got to eat the Lord's Supper. You got to get circumcised. We got this ceremony coming up, you know, Christmas dinner, Easter dinner. Yeah, we got these ceremonies. You got to do some sacrifices. There's still people that still do that now. You know, sacrifices, tithing, taking it. You got to do all this stuff, see?
Yeah.
That's not faith. Those are works. See, those are cardinal ordinances restored. How did they get restored? How did it get like that? See, we kind of went through it last week. Where's it at? Get me Acts 15th chapter.
Are you finished with Hebrews?
Finish Hebrews.
Finish it?
Finish it.
Of the doctrine of baptisms, of laying on of hands, and the resurrection of dead, and the eternal judgment. Mm-hmm. And this will we do if Yahweh permits.
Now this will we
for
do.
It is impossible for those who were once enlightened and have tasted of the heavenly gift.
And that is what happened to a lot. Because look, folks have come and gone.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And they have, and we have preached. Mm-hmm. See, and they have tasted this heavenly gift. Because we heard them say, so, oh, you know, this is interesting. I see some, you know. I mean, and I've been around long enough to hear the myriad of declarations, you know, after somebody comes and says, oh, yeah, this is great. And then you don't see them. Mm-hmm. See, they tasted the fruit, but for whatever reason, they dropped the apple or threw it away. They didn't finish it. They just went on. Mm-hmm. But we...
And were made partakers of the Holy Spirit,
uh-huh.
and have tasted the good word of Yahweh and the powers of the world to come.
Read.
If they shall fall away, to renew them again unto repentance, mm-hmm. seeing they crucify to themselves the Son of Yahweh afresh.
They call him a liar. That's all they're saying. Mm-hmm. And see, I like to say it like this, if the second speaker kind of touched on it with these veils. See, we're in the veil renting business. So you come in here with a closed veil. Mm-hmm. We could put a sign on the door and say, veils ripped, guaranteed. By the end of the hour, veils will be ripped. By the end, if you sit here for two now, you know, there's some people can't, you know, when they feel the ripping of the veil, they can't stand it. They'll leave before the class is over.
Yeah.
If it starts ripping, no, no, I can't, you know, because they feel it ripping. But if you stay here for the total 2 hours of the class, see this veil, see this veil will be ripped in twain.
Mm-hmm.
See now, you will be, that veil will be ripped. Guaranteed, no exception. Don't care who you are, you know, highborn or lowborn. When you come in these doors and you sit down here for 2 hours and you truly hear the gospel being preached, your veil will be ripped. Okay? The question is, at the end of class, what will you do with that rent veil? Will you leave it unrent? Or will you just take it and leave the door and say, well, you know something, this ain't bad, but you know, I don't think I'm going to go with this. And you're going to get your needle out and you're going to sew this back up. See. Or if it's ripped out, you know, and cast out to the floor, see, you know, you just say, well, you know, this is pretty good. It's a nice place. You can sneak in there. Yeah, it's not bad. Pick it up. Yeah, all right, you know. Stick it in your pants. All right, yeah, okay. I'm see y'all. You take it on out the door, and then you'll sew it back up.
Mm-hmm.
But when you come in here and you sit down, that veil is going to be rent.
Yeah.
Bar none. The question is, when you leave here, will it remain rent? Or will you sew it back up? See, that's what we read that scripture for. See, because there are people that tasted the good word, mm-hmm. see, but then they turned away from it. In other words, they sewed it back up. And as Yahweh, Yahshua said, hey, look, the last state of that man is worse than the first.
Yeah.
See.
What are the three trips in the mountain?
I'm sorry?
The three trips in the mountain.
The three trips in the mountain. You want the three trips in the mountain?
Sure, yeah.
Okay. Let me change my subject here. Okay. Well, what can I say? I have to yield to the demands of the
body, of people.
Yeah. Well, the spirit speaks. You know. Yeah.
You promise.
Now, since we're gonna do that, take it one.
All three of them.
Since you demanded it, we're gonna give you the deluxe special. All right. He demanded three trips in the mountain. He demanded it too.
Promise.
Now, I had these plates up here. There's a reason why these plates are up here. Because see, this is plate 29, plate 30, plate 31. These three plates represent Yahshua's fulfillment of Moses' three trips into the mountain. Mm-hmm. Plate 29, Sermon on the Mount, is a fulfillment of Moses' first trip on the mountain. Plate 30 is a fulfillment of Moses' second trip into the mountain. Mm-hmm. And plate 31 is the fulfillment of Moses' third trip into the mountain. Okay? Now, because what we want to do here, at least what little time I have left, and I'm going to have to speed through this, but hopefully you'll get the gist of it. Because the second speaker went through and he showed you about the steps in the pattern and the various vessels thereof. Well, these charts go according to the pattern as well. See? Now we'll take the first one here. We'll take plate 29. Let's see. Just trying to give you an idea how it goes. Here's Yahshua coming in. A prepared sacrificial body. We have this dark circle with a cross in the middle. Now what that is representing is simply this. Yahshua is walking around with his blood running warm in his veins, and he is held over as a prepared sacrifice. Why? Because when I draw a line, because we say line upon line, precept upon precept, we're going to draw a line. And where do we come to? We come to that lamb down here in Egypt that was drawn out on the 10th of Abib and held over to the 14th. Killed between the two evenings. What does that mean? At 12 o'clock noon, which is 3.5 days. Mm. Alright? Without spot or blemish, killed kosher style. No bones to be broken, right? Now that lamb points to Yahshua, which is, that's the same as going to happen to him. But what's happening here is now he's getting ready to go into his ministry. How long? Yeah. 3.5 years, just like that lamb is being drawn out. Mm. Okay? He goes in here and gets John's water baptism. Maybe we can read this. Matthew 3 and 11. Quickly, because we have it.
Matthew 3:11.
I'm pressed.
Here. I indeed immerse you with water unto repentance. But he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. Mm-hmm. He shall immerse you with the Holy Spirit and with fire, whose fan is in his hand. And he will thoroughly purge his floor.
Okay, so now here's Yahshua. He's getting baptized. He's getting baptized in fulfillment, come over here, of the Israelites. Because they got baptized in the cloud and in the sea. Get down to where John's baptized. What is that, 3:13? Yeah.
Then cometh Yahshua from Galilee to Jordan unto John to be immersed of him.
Uh-huh.
But John forbade him, saying,
mm-hmm.
I have need to be immersed of thee.
Read.
And cometh thou to me?
Mm-hmm.
And Yahshua answering said unto him, permit it to be so now,
mm-hmm.
for thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness.
So now John baptizing him, see, is a fulfillment of the Israelites. See, Yahshua is representing that whole body of Israel. All 12 tribes being immersed unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea. So Yahshua is being baptized unto John. See, read.
Then he permitted him. Yahshua, when he was immersed, went up straightway out of the water, and lo, the heavens were opened unto him.
Mm-hmm.
And he saw the Spirit of Yahweh descend like a dove and lighting upon him.
See, like a dove. See, the Spirit. See, so now he's baptized in the water. And in the Spirit, see, unto John, just like, come over here, Israel is baptized unto Moses in the cloud, which is the type of the Spirit, mm-hmm. and in the water. Okay? Keep reading.
And lo, a voice from heaven saying, this is my beloved son, in whom I am well pleased. Then was Yahshua led up of the spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the adversary. After he had fasted for 40 days.
Now he's out here 40 days. Why 40 days? Remember, prophetic time. Numbers 14th chapter says about a day for a year and a year for a day. Why 40 days? Come over here. How long was the Israelites in the wilderness of Sinai?
40 years,
okay? See, we're looking for the principles here. See, the migratory trek and or the tabernacle pattern. Mm-hmm. See, because you're correlating both principles onto these events. Because why? Because it's being dictated by spirit law. Mm-hmm. Okay, keep reading.
And after he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry.
Mm-hmm.
And then the tempter came to him and said, if thou be the son of Yahweh, command that these stones be made bread.
Now see, he said, command that these stones be made bread. Why? Why would he say that? Well, let's look at the pattern, see? We're in the holy place here. Mm-hmm. Come over here. Let's look at the holy place in the pattern. Mm-hmm. It was brought up. We got a table of shewbread here.
Right.
See, we got a lampstand and an altar of incense, see?
Mm-hmm.
So now in the holy place, see, we got that. In the holy place in the wilderness, see, what happened? Manna was rained from heaven,
mm-hmm.
see? And that cloud that led them out of Egypt was a cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. So that was the light, mm-hmm. just like the lampstand. And see, and that cloud, see, had an angel in there, see? And that angel, see, had Yahweh's name in it. See, that cloud, see, that represented Joshua, son of Nun. Because he was the intercessor. You see, he's the one that, see, Moses was the one they had to go to, but Moses had to go to somebody. He had to go to Joshua.
There you go.
See, so, he had, so that's an intercessor. See, that's like the golden altar of incense here. Okay, so now let's go back over here to this holy place in the story. Keep reading.
But he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of Yahweh.
And just to make a quick note, because we don't have time to get it, the stones that he wanted him to turn into bread were not just a bunch of rocks that you just kick around.
Mm-hmm.
They were stones, they were landmarks, see, when the Israelites came across the Jordan River.
Right, right.
See, when Joshua the son, you can read in the, I think it's the third or fourth chapter of the book of Joshua, when the Jordan River divided just like the Red Sea did, and they took stones out of there and they set it onto the side as a landmark so that they would, people would know where they crossed. These stones here is the same stones that the adversary is trying to tempt Joshua with to turn into bread.
Right. Exactly.
Okay, read.
Then the adversary taketh him up into the holy city and setteth him upon a pinnacle of the temple and said unto him, if thou be the son of Yahweh, cast thyself down, for it is written, he shall give his angels charge concerning thee to guard thee in all thy ways, and in their hands they shall bear thee up.
But I see, not saying this. Satan is quoting scripture to this guy. So you can say, in the medieval times, it used to be a thing where they said, you just quote the scriptures to the Bible, to the devil. His tongue would burn if he recited them. You know, that's what people used to say. Well, he's reciting them now. He doesn't have to do it. And he's talking to the boss himself. Okay? So now he's telling him, he said, oh, man, come on, you know this. You wrote this, man. Mm-hmm. If you jump off him, then the angels, they're going to save you.
Mm-hmm.
See? But read.
And that they shall bear thee up, lest at any time thou dash thy foot against a stone.
Mm-hmm.
Yahshua said unto him, it is written again, thou shalt not tempt Yahweh thy Elohim.
See, why? Because that's what happened back here in the wilderness. See, the adversary tempted or tested the Israelites. See, that's why Paul writes over in 10th chapter of 1 Corinthians about these snakes. These that came up and bit them, see? Yeah. And they had to erect a bronze snake on a pole and lift it up and look at it.
Yeah.
See? So that they would be healed. See, that was a type, see, pointing to Yahshua the second. See, Yahshua was fulfilling everything, including that, because that was the snake. He was fulfilling that as well. But don't have time here, but keep on.
Again, the adversary taketh him up into an exceedingly high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world.
Showed him all the kingdoms of the world. This doesn't do it justice. Let me show you all the kingdoms of the world.
Yeah, right on.
Here they are, right here.
Yeah.
Pagan Rome, Papal Rome, Greece, Media, Persia, Babylon, Tower of Babel, City of Enoch, those are the best ones. And then all the rest of the empires and kingdoms that ever existed on the earth, even the ones you probably never heard of.
Mm-hmm.
All of them. They're just now discovering, civilizations that say, oh, we didn't know these people existed. Well, let me tell you something. They were the devils too.
Mm-hmm.
All the kingdoms of the earth. And look, And the devil said, look, if you just bow down and worship me, I'll give them to you. Hmm. See, now that's great deception, because you know why? The one who he's talking to was the one that gave them to him.
Yeah, yeah.
But read.
Right. Him, all the kingdoms of the world and the glory of them.
Mm-hmm.
And said unto him, all these things I will give thee if thou wilt fall down and worship me.
Mm-hmm.
Then saith Yahshua unto him, get thee hence, Satan, for it is written, thou shalt worship thy Elohim, Yahweh thy Elohim, and him only shalt thou serve. Then the adversary leaveth him, and behold, angels came and ministered
unto him. And angels came and ministered unto him. Why? Mm-hmm. Come over here and draw the line. Who was ministering back here in the wilderness of Sinai?
Moses' minister.
Who was Moses' minister?
Joshua.
Why? Who was the angel in the cloud?
Joshua.
Ministering.
Yeah.
See that now? Okay.
Right.
Read.
Now when Joshua had heard that John was cast into prison, he departed into Galilee. And leaving Nazareth, he came and dwelt in Capernaum, which is upon the seacoast in the border of Zebulun and Naphtali, in fulfillment of that which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, mm-hmm. saying, the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, by the way of the sea beyond Jordan, Galilee of the nations. The people which walk in darkness have seen great light, and to them which dwelleth in the regions of the shadow of death, light has shined upon them.
Light, why would it say that there? Just draw a line. Isn't there light in the holy place here?
Right.
The lampstand?
Yeah.
What was the light in the wilderness?
It's pillar of fire.
Cloud by day.
Yeah.
Pillar of fire by night.
Yeah.
See? Everything he's doing is a fulfillment.
Yeah.
All right? We need to expedite this. Jump down to 23.
And Yahshua went about all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and mm-hmm. preaching the gospel of the kingdom and healing all manners of sickness and all manners of disease among the people. And his family all Syria, and they brought unto him all sick people that were taken with various diseases and torments,
mm-hmm.
and those which were possessed with demons, and those which were lunatics, and those that were paralytic, and he healed them. And there followed him great multitudes of people from Galilee, and from Decapolis, and from Jerusalem, and from Judea,
and the Jordan. And from beyond the Jordan. When it says from beyond the Jordan, that means on the other side of the Jordan. What side are you talking about? This side.
Mm-hmm.
See, now when we go back to the wilderness, Moses died, and he was buried here in Mount Nebo, and Joshua took over, and there was a new birth here, because the 603,550 that came up out of Egypt died out here in the wilderness because of unbelief.
Yeah.
But that 144,000 of that new birth that was born out here, they followed Joshua, the son of Nun, into Canaan's land. So Joshua's leading a multitude. See, that's 144. And then the rest of the people.
Yeah.
So he's leading a multitude from beyond the Jordan.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Because Yahshua, we just read Yahshua. See, he went out preaching him and healing people the sick. And people followed him from everywhere. And he was on the other side of the Jordan. And so now he crossed the Jordan and all these multitudes is following him in fulfillment of the multitudes following Joshua, the son of Nun, when he crossed into Canaan's land.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, read.
And now seeing the multitude, he went up unto the mountain, and when he was set, his disciples came unto him.
Uh-huh.
And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying,
mm-hmm.
blessed are the poor in spirit,
uh-huh.
for theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
Why? He said, blessed are the poor in spirit. What are you talking about? See, these so-called beatitudes is really nothing but a fulfillment of the actions that happened back here
mm-hmm.
in the migratory trek. Because it says, read that again quickly.
Blessed are the poor in spirit.
The Israelites, they were poor in spirit. But read.
For theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
For theirs is the kingdom of heaven. In other words, theirs is the promised land. Because
mm-hmm.
that's what Canaan's land was a type of.
Yeah.
Okay, read.
Blessed are they that mourn because of sin.
Uh-huh.
For they shall be comforted.
See, now they were mourning because they were down here slaving. They were mourning, oh yeah, oh El, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But they were comforted. In other words, they were delivered. Comforted, or they resurrected out of that state.
Mm-hmm.
Read.
Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth.
Moses was the meekest man that ever walked the earth, according to the scriptures. And he was taken up into this cloud and shown the visions of the heavens and
the earth.
Yeah.
Inheriting the earth. Mm-hmm. Because he saw the vision twice.
Right.
See? Yeah. saw the man and woman are up in peace and harmony, and in their rest, come back down, saw the Israelite build a golden calf, deals with it, goes back up, sees a rerun, then he sees the transgression and the subsequent generations of the flesh coming out of that on the earth.
Yeah.
See, that's him inheriting the earth. Read.
Blessed are they that do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled.
Didn't they get hungry out here? So Yahweh had to get a manna from heaven, quail, water from the rocks. That's just a type in the shadow of the spiritual hunger that they had out here. See? Okay, read.
Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy.
That's what happened up here. See, Elohim told me, he said, look, I will be merciful on whom I will be merciful to. See, because they sinned, and Moses offered himself up, because he looked at Elohim, and he saw that he was that book of life. And he saw his name written in that book of life. And so he told Moses, pleaded with Elohim, and said, well, look, for the sins of Israel, look, blot my name out of that book. And but Elohim said, look, I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy on. Okay, read.
Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see Yahweh.
That's what happened to Moses. What are you talking about? Was Moses pure in heart? Not him, but the Holy Spirit in him was, because he was born with the Holy Spirit down here in Egypt. See? And that made him pure in heart. Not him of himself, but the Spirit in him.
Right.
See? All right? Read.
Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of Yahweh.
They'll be called the children of Yahweh. And some Bible says they'll be called the son of Yahweh. See, that was Joshua. See, the peacemaker back here was Joshua the son of Nun. Anytime they had a problem, you know, like, for example, like the Amalekites was out here. They would go to Joshua and say, hey, Josh, Amalek is and his boys is outside the camp. They're causing a ruckus. Quite frankly, they're disturbing the peace. Why don't you get some fellows together and just go out here and handle it for us, would you please? So Joshua got some boys, strapped on their swords, and they went out there and they took care of it. And they took care of Amalek. And when that last Amalekite fell, peace had been restored. It's no different today. Somebody's, you know, got a party next door and they're disturbing your sleep, you got to go to work and whatnot. Who do you call? You call the peacemakers. Well, who are the peacemakers? Well, the popos, of course. They're going to come and they're going to, hey, peacemaker, y'all need to cut it out or we're going to run you in. See, I live near L.A., I live near the federal building where they do a lot of protests and stuff, you know. Especially when the Iraq war was strong, you know, the protests, and they would be out there blocking the streets with the signs, stop the war, stop the war, and they're blocking traffic and stuff like that. You know, people think, oh, they're the peacemakers because they're protesting the war. No, they're not. They're the disruptors because they're causing traffic on Wilshire Avenue. I'm riding my bicycle. I can't get through this throng of cloud here and whatnot. So what you got to do? You got to call the peacemakers. Who are they again? The popos. And said, okay, y'all need to get off the street, man. You're blocking the thoroughway, you know. We know you got First Amendment rights, but you don't have the right to block this, you know, the thoroughway. You know, get over here, you know, that kind of thing, you know.
Yeah.
Get them Irish cops out there. Oh, I should have got a bomb. Read.
Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
That's what happened out here. They were persecuted out here by warring tribes. They were surrounded by warring tribes out here. Okay, read.
Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you, and shall say all manners of evil against you for my sake. Rejoice and be excitingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven.
Now see, now that's what happens out here, because they have, if you read back the numbers about Balaam, who was a hireling prophet that a king hired to put a curse on, you know, on Israel. But Yahweh, you know, had different plans, you know, told him, you know, well, you read the story where, you know, his donkey talked to him, you know, because he saw an angel on the road who was going to kill him. See, but that just mentioned in the story, because that's a fulfillment of that. Okay? Where we at here? Quickly, need to jump down. Give me these scriptures, because I need to move on here. 21.
Ye have heard that it was said by them of old time, thou shalt not commit murder.
Now that's
and
what,
whosoever committeth murder shall be in danger of the court of justice.
Now see, now that's what Yahshua said from the mount.
Yeah.
Why? Because remember, at Moses' first trip in the mount, what happened? Elohim spoke down the Ten Commandment law to the hearing of the Israelites. So now his conversation, talking about Yahshua on the mount, in fulfillment, has to be similar. What's the next one?
27.
Quickly.
We have heard that in old time,
that it was said by them all the time, thou shalt not commit adultery.
Why? Because that's what was said from the mount back here that Yahweh spoke down. Mm-hmm. He's just fulfilling it, okay? Give me another one.
Neither shall thou swear by
where are you head. At?
36. Neither shall thou 30, swear.
Try 33.
Again, ye have heard that it has been said by them of old time, thou shalt not swear to a lie, but shall make unto Yahweh thine oath.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
But I say unto you, swear not at all.
43.
Yeah, that 43. That was spoken to, the 43, yeah. Mm-hmm. See, he's just saying the same thing in conversation, in fulfillment to what Elohim spoke from the mount.
Right.
Okay, quickly.
38. You have heard that it has been said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for
43.
A tooth. 43. Uh-huh. Ye have heard that in heaven said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thine enemy.
But I say,
hello.
Oh, but I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you, that ye may be the children of your Father which is in heaven. For he maketh the sun to rise on the evil and on the good, and sendeth rain on the just and on the unjust.
That's good enough. Now, that's just to give you an idea to show you, see, mm-hmm. you know, you can get more persnickety, but see, but this gives you an idea. Here's Yahshua in his Sermon on the Mount. He's fulfilling mm-hmm. Moses' first trip in the Mount. Oh. See, now over here, see, this is the miracles of transformation. This is Moses' second trip in the Mount in fulfillment. We already told you what this is. Quickly get Matthew 8:23. I need speed racer here.
Matthew 8:23.
And when he was entered into a ship, his disciples followed him. And behold, there arose a great tempest in the sea, insomuch that the ship was covered with the waves, but he was asleep. And his disciples came to him and woke him, saying, Master, save us, we perish. And he saith unto them, why are ye fearful, ye of little faith? Then he arose and rebuked the winds and the sea, and there was a great calm.
Mm-hmm.
But the men marveled, saying, what manner of man is this, that even the winds and the sea obey him?
Okay, see, that the winds and the sea obey him. Why? Because he represented the law of the Spirit in physical form, and they recognized that.
Mm-hmm.
That, you know, because, you know, the reason why they obey, because, oh, we know who you are. You were there at my inception.
Mm-hmm.
That's why they obey. See, back, just draw a line. Mm-hmm. See, Moses, you know, was told, you know, lift the rod up,
yeah.
you know, and lead these people forward. And when he did that, see, the sea divided. Now, it wasn't Moses that was doing that.
Mm-hmm.
It was the law of the Spirit standing next to him that was doing that.
Mm-hmm.
That was Joshua, son of Nun.
Right.
But he couldn't be revealed at that point because they couldn't let the people see it. So they just saw Moses lifting up the rod. But it wasn't Moses that's doing that. That was Joshua. That was the law of the Spirit. Standing
mm-hmm.
next to him,
mm-hmm.
doing that. Okay, read.
Very. Keep reading. But the yes. men marveled, saying, what manner of man is this that even the winds and the sea obey him? And when he was come to the other side into the country of the Gergesenes, there met him two possessed with devils
uh-huh.
coming out of the tombs,
mm-hmm.
exceeding fierce, so that no man might pass by that way. And behold, they cried out, saying, what have we to do with thee, Yahshua, thou son of Yahweh? Art thou come hither to torment us before the time?
Mm-hmm.
And there was a good way off from them, and heard of many swine feeding. So the devil besought him, saying, if they cast us out, suffer us to go away into the herd of swine. And he said unto them, go. And when they were come out, they went into the herd of swine.
Uh-huh.
And behold, the whole herd of swine ran violently down a steep place into the sea and perished in the waters.
Okay, why? Draw a line. Come over here to the migratory trek. Who drowned in the Red Sea?
Pharaoh
and his host.
Yeah.
See, why? Because see, look, come on back over here. In the story, Yahshua had to pass by two men.
Mm-hmm.
See, he got out the boat, he had to pass by two men. Why? Come over here. What's that? The Red Sea. What, didn't the Israelites have to pass through two mountains?
Oh, yeah.
See?
Yeah.
This is a fulfillment of what's happening with Pharaoh back there. So now, the demons incarnated in the swine, and they drowned in the sea. Just like Pharaoh, the demons that were incarnated in Pharaoh's army,
mm-hmm.
they drowned in the Red Sea.
Mm-hmm.
That's what that's a fulfillment of, okay? Now, coming over here, we got his ministry and miracles, see? And see, we don't have time to really go through it all, but see, we got Lazarus raised from the dead here. And see, during his ministry and miracles, one of the miracles he did was that he took five fishes and two loaves of bread. Was it five loaves of bread and two loaves of fish? Yeah, five loaves of bread and two fishes, and he fed a multitude.
Mm-hmm.
Bread, five loaves of bread.
Yeah. There you go. Yeah.
You see, bread here, manna here. You understand?
Yeah.
See, his miracles and stuff. And see, here, he told, well, maybe we should get it quickly, John 11th chapter. You know, because you see, if I say it, you probably wouldn't believe it, but we can read it.
John 11:1?
Yeah, quickly.
Now, a certain man was sick named Lazarus of Bethany, the town of Miriam, and her sister Martha. It was that Miriam which anointed Yahshua with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. Therefore his sister sent unto him, saying, Rabbi, behold, he whom thou lovest is sick. When Yahshua heard that, he said, This sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of Yahweh, that the Son of Yahweh might be glorified thereby.
Okay, now this is the reason why. He's coming down because Lazarus, but actually what happened was, he's on his way and Lazarus died. On his way there, okay? And so now they're up here, they're sad, and so now he's going to raise Lazarus from the dead. See, and he's telling them that he's the light, that he's the resurrection and the life, see? And also, which he is also the light that shineth every man's heart, see? This is the reason why we're all alive. And so now he's going to resurrect Lazarus from the dead, and when he stands up to the grave, and he calls out. He has to call out Lazarus by name. See, because if he don't call, if he just, he says, Lazarus, come forth. If he just says, come forth, everybody in the grave would get up and come forth. So he had to call him by name for that person to come up out of, you know, out of the grave, out of degradation.
Yeah,
it's no different today.
Very good.
See, because Yahweh, because see, we were all in, you know, in the grave, that to say, in Egypt, spiritually speaking. And it's Yahweh that calls us out of Egypt or out of darkness by name. We always say, you know, when you come here, you have a divine invitation. Well, look, that divine invitation involves your name.
Yeah.
Because when you get an invitation, you know, it's going to say to so-and-so, to whoever, you know. It's not going to say that, you know, just to blank. No, it's going to be specific to, you know, to Dr. Samuel's, you know. Specific, Dr. But, you know, it's going to be specific by divine invitation, by name. That's what he did. He called Lazarus out by name, and Lazarus resurrected from the grave.
Yeah.
Yahshua is calling us all by name, and he's resurrecting us out of Egypt.
Yeah.
Right? So now, and see, and he's the intercessor. See, Yahshua himself is the intercessor. See, doing all of this, okay? Now, quickly get 17th chapter of Matthew. And see, now this is Moses' second trip into the mount, as we have illustrated here.
Yeah.
See? Hurry.
And after 17:1, and after 6 days, Yahshua taketh Peter, James, and John, his brother, and bringeth them up into a high mountain apart.
Now after 6 days, that was, it was on the seventh day that they went up on this mountain. See, we...
It was transfigured before them.
And he was transfigured before them. Here, we got it up here. He's transfigured, see? Read.
And his face did shine as the sun, and his raiment was white as the light. And behold, there appeared unto them Moses and Elias.
Moses and Elias, see? Him. It's just like, see, you come over here. The Ark of the Covenant, you got the flash of the Shekinah, and you got flanked, you know, the cloud that sat on the mercy seat, flanked by Michael and Gabriel. See, over here. Now, we have this illustration over here, because we always use this. We say this. See, we got Peter, James, and John. Peter was the elder. James and John's were brother. Come over here. See, this is the fulfillment of Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu. Aaron was the elder. Nadab and Abihu were brothers. There were 70 elders. You see, and all these folks, they saw this. They saw this, and not long afterwards, 70 were chosen to go out two by two to spread the gospel. See, but keep reading quickly.
Then answered Peter and said unto Yahshua, Sire, it is good for us to be here. If thou wilt, let us make here three tabernacles, one for thee, one for Moses, and one for Elias. While he yet spoke, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and behold, a voice out of the cloud which said, This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased.
Okay, so now this is him, see, appearing in the cloud. See, why? Just like Moses appeared in the cloud. Up here, keep reading.
I am well pleased. Hear ye him. And when the disciples heard it, they fell on their face and were sore afraid. And Yahshua came and touched them and said, Arise, be not afraid.
Now Peter, yeah, I think you read it, but said Peter mentions it, let's build three tabernacles. Why? Because on the second trip of Moses when he went up here, that's when Elohim revealed to him the tabernacle. See, on that second trip. That's why Peter says over here, oh, well, let's build three tabernacles. See, that's why he says that. See, okay? Now, I'm out of time, but just to go through it just very, very quickly, this third plate here, this is Moses' third trip into the mount as a fulfillment. We got Yahshua in his death, his burial, his resurrection. And see, and he tarried on earth for 40 days. And then he ascended, see, which means that, you know, he went into the cloud. Maybe you should read that quickly. Hurry up. Acts 1 and 11 or something, somewhere around there. Hurry up. 1 and 9.
Acts 1 and 9. And when he said, when he had spoken these things while they beheld, he was taken up in a cloud.
He was taken in a cloud. Why? Because that's what happened to the high priest on the Day of Atonement. Mm-hmm. He had to come here to the altar of incense with the censer, get the coals from there, and he came up on a cloud. That's why you see this cloud here. Mm-hmm. He's coming up on a cloud. So now he's got to go up on a cloud. Mm-hmm. Read.
And when he was spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight.
Uh-huh.
And while they looked steadfastly toward heaven, mm-hmm. and as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel,
mm-hmm.
which also said, "Ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This time, this same Yahshua, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall so come in like manner as ye have seen him go into the heaven."
Now see, now people think that because they saw him on a cloud, and people think, oh, well, he's going to come back on, he's going to be floating on a cloud coming back down. That's not what's going to happen. For this reason. This was a vision, and we got it written there. They saw this in a vision.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So now if he left in a vision, then when he comes back, so to speak, it would have to be in a vision.
Yeah.
How did that mean? Does that mean what? That means that when you come in this door and we call you out by name, mm-hmm. and Yahweh Elohim appears to you in your cloud,
there you go.
Then he has returned.
There you go. Mm-hmm. There
to you.
Right on.
See?
Yeah.
See, that's what that's talking about. But the world is waiting for, I don't know, they're waiting for a physical manifestation. And even if that were the case, if Jesus Christ, I'll say it like that, was to come down here at Ontario Airport, mm-hmm. see, nobody in L.A. would be able to see it.
Mm.
For that matter, this is the light side of the world. People on the dark side of the world, they wouldn't see nothing.
Mm-hmm. Right, right.
See? Because if you're going to talk about a universal revelation, then how would it have to be? It can't be a physical one. It would have to be a spiritual one, because so we're all can see. It would have to be inside this cloud.
That's right.
Not on a physical one.
Thank you.
Then get to that. See, and look, and listen, when Moses and when Yahshua is returning, see, because he went up on the cloud, and then here on the day of Pentecost, so this is the fulfillment of Moses' third trip into the mount. See, he's going up on the cloud, and then he's returning, pouring out the Holy Spirit. Him pouring out the Holy Spirit is a fulfillment of Moses coming back down the third trip with the second tables of stone,
mm-hmm.
which he had to write, which he had to carve out,
right.
and put back in the mountain, which Elohim wrote in his heart. Why? Because it signifies the Holy Spirit here on the day of Pentecost,
mm-hmm.
being written in your heart,
okay.
and in your mind.
Yeah.
See. Now that's, like I said, we can get more persnickety, but that's pretty much what it's showing you when we show these three plates. These are represents Moses' three trips into the mount.
Mm.
Third trip, second trip, the first trip. And there's a whole lot more, but come back and learn about it. And with those few words.
We ought to truly thank the Father for allowing us to hold class this morning. We hold classes every Tuesday and Friday from 7:30 to 9:30, Sunday morning from 11 to 1, and the last Sunday of every month we have a Spanish class from 9:30 to 10:30. So come back again and study with us. Bring your friends and all your enemies and stand for the doxology.
I'm going to be gone for 3 weeks, so I need someone to take the attendance.
Okay.
And all I need is speakers and attendance and a number. And also, if anybody wants any discs, the Lloyd will make the copies.
All right.
And the next business will be in August 9th, I believe it is.
August 9th, yeah. Okay. And on Tuesdays, we have what we call a workshop. So you can come and ask any type of questions that you want. Okay. So. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, along glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both be all for all time, now and ever. Let us all say,
Hallelujah.
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 Yeah, I know he did, because he came to my house one night. I had a